Okay, let's start. Today I want to give a look to the electric sector. And I want to convince you that there are many things which are basically the same. As in QCD, of course, there are important differences, and important things usually lie in the differences. But we need to understand first which kind of phenomena are exactly the same, why. And if you understand that, then there are many things that you can get the result without doing any difficult calculation. Okay, so everybody knows what is going on. The Higgs has been discovered finally, and now we know precisely the mass, for instance. We know that it is a boson. We know that it has all the properties that the standard model was predicting. So it's a great success of the standard model. In fact, it's more than a success, because if you will have asked just 5 years ago to 100 different theorists what they will believe about the Higgs, whether it will be discovered or not, probably you will be surprised about the answer. Okay, so it was not so obvious that that was the thing to find, and I want to show you why. Because there are many things that we say about the Higgs which are not really true. Okay, it's a very nice mechanism. The mechanism now we know that is there, and but it's not so compelling as other parts of the standard model. One needs to understand why, and then once we understand why, then we can start asking questions. Why some things work, why some others we don't understand, and things like that. Because there is a lot of physics hidden that we don't really understand what is going on. So let's go by parts. Whatever this object is, it is a fundamental discovery. Okay? Not because it's the Higgs of the standard model. The fundamental discovery is that this object has been found. Why? Because from the very beginning, we saw an object which decays to two photons. So from the very beginning, we knew that it was a boson, and we knew that its spin was different from one, because an object with a spin one cannot decay into two photons. It's forbidden by usual conservation rules. Okay, you just use Bose statistics and angular momentum conservation, and you can prove that the object cannot have a spin one. Now, of course, we know more. We know that with a 95% probability is a zero minus object, sorry, a zero plus object. Okay? But from the very beginning, we knew that it didn't have a spin one. And you also have learned that matter are fermions and forces are bosons in the usual structure in fundamental physics. So what we had discovered is a boson that needs a new field of force, which is not gauge. So it's different from all the other forces we were aware. Of course, that's what the standard model has built in, but it's not something so obvious from the very beginning. In the standard model, this is a mechanism that was invented in order to get something that didn't work. Okay, but it was not something coming from the gauge principle. So now you have two attitudes. One is, you have really discovered a fundamental boson. But it is, in that case, is a new interaction which is not gauge. Second, is the first fundamental boson of this type. Okay, it's the first scalar that we say is a fundamental boson. All other scalar particles we are aware with are just composite states in the hadronic world. So it's something new. The other, you say, no, it cannot be a scalar, a fundamental particle, because I have some theoretical prejudices. It should be a composite object. But if it is a composite object, there should be an underlying interaction making this composite object. So there is a new interaction in any case. Okay? Of course, within the standard model framework, this new interaction is the Higgs field. Okay, but It is a new interaction in any case, either if the standard model is the reason or if the standard model is not the reason. People emphasize a lot this type of arguments because usually theories don't like fundamental scalars. And there are very good reasons why you don't like fundamental scalars. And the reasons have to do with symmetries and have to do with stability. So let me do the argument. One should be careful with the argument because usually the argument is formulated in some way which is totally misleading and quite often wrong. Okay. Let's assume that there is new physics at some scale, and this is the crucial point. Because if the standard model is everything, forget about whatever I am going to say. The standard model does not have any problem. Okay. But let's assume that there is new physics at some scale, lambda new physics. So lambda new physics is not a cutoff. You cannot make any physics talking about cutoffs, talking about regularization. Lambda new physics is a true fundamental new physics scale, where there are physical objects which have this type of mass. So it's a physical mass scale. So if such physical mass scale exists, and we believe it should exist because there are many things that the standard model don't answer, so but you go beyond the standard model, then in the moment you make a quantum correction to some scalar object, you find quantum corrections to the mass of this scalar object, which are proportional to the new mass scale. So in the moment some scalar object couples to some other field, whatever it is, which has a heavier mass scale, quantum corrections tend to put the two scales at the same level. Okay. Why this happens? Well, a priori, quantum corrections, there is a law if you want to understand them, and the law is whatever is not forbidden happens. Okay. If you want something not to happen in a quantum field theory, you need a symmetry that forbids this to happen. Otherwise, at some point, maybe it will not happen at one loop, it will happen at two loops or at three loops, but if something is not forbidden, it happens. If you look about fermions, fermion masses are protected by chiral symmetry. I will show that more explicitly in a moment. The masses of the gauge bosons are protected by gauge symmetry. You know, gauge symmetry forces the masses to be zero. But there is no symmetry protecting the mass of the scalar boson. Since there is no symmetry protecting this mass, in the moment you do quantum corrections will try to mix the masses. So let me make that a little bit more explicit. You take a free fermion, so that's the Dirac Lagrangian, and what is chiral symmetry? We were discussing chiral symmetry yesterday all the time. Okay, but here I am just putting one fermion without flavors. So you can make a phase transformation of the left and right chiralities of the fermion independently. Since the kinetic Lagrangian, the derivative term, splits left from right because it contains a gamma mu. While the mass term does not contain any gamma mu, so mixes left and right. So if you put the mass equal to zero, the Dirac Lagrangian has a chiral symmetry. And the chiral symmetry gets broken by the mass. So there is a limit, a symmetry, in which the mass is exactly zero. Now you can make as many quantum corrections you want. If the starting point is mass equal to zero, you will never generate the mass. Because your loops preserve the symmetry. Okay. In the standard model is a chiral theory. It distinguishes left from right. That's why everybody in the standard model is massless. And you need the Higgs mechanism to generate the masses. So once you have masses, the mass term is a small breaking of chiral symmetry. And of course, then quantum corrections can generate masses. but they can only generate masses proportionally to the parameter which broke the symmetry. So you can be sure that any quantum correction to any fermion mass will be proportional to the fermion mass itself. Because in the limit where you put this mass equal to zero, the quantum correction should also go to zero. So fermions are protected. Gauge bosons, let's take the simplest case. So you just take, for instance, the photon. Let's assume that you put a photon mass by hand. This photon mass breaks gauge symmetry. That's the reason why it is not there. So there is a limit. In the limit where you put the mass equal to zero, the symmetry is exact, and you will never generate a photon mass from loops. If now you say, this is not a photon, it's something else, and I put a mass, you can be sure that any quantum correction adding to this mass will be proportional to this mass. Because in the limit that you put the mass to zero, it should disappear. Okay? What happens with the scalars? There is no obvious symmetry that protects the scalar mass. Since there is no obvious symmetry that protects the scalar mass, if now you add to this Lagrangian a second object with a completely different mass, much heavier than this one, which interacts with this scalar, then quantum corrections will tend to mix the two mass scales. So in the moment there is a second mass scale, the second mass scale can give a mass to this scalar, even if you put the masses of the scalar equal to zero. And that's why nobody likes fundamental scalars, because they are not stable under quantum corrections. Well, this is not completely true. I am saying they are. Is there any symmetry? Well, there are a few symmetries. One is the one we saw yesterday, Goldstone bosons. Goldstone bosons are characterized, they go, are excitations along the flat direction of the potential, along the valley, communicating one vacuum with another vacuum. So in any system with Goldstone bosons, the dynamics is invariant under a shift of the field by a constant. And that's why the Goldstone interactions always contain a derivative. Okay? So if now you implement this kind of symmetry in all your theory, whatever fields you put there, okay, then you are protecting the mass of this object. It will be zero. This object will only get a mass provided you break the symmetry. And then you can have a small parameter that breaks the symmetry, and quantum corrections will always be proportional to this parameter. That's why nowadays probably you hear a lot talking about the idea that the Higgs maybe is a pseudo-Goldstone boson of some symmetry that we don't know. Okay, so there is some hidden model which makes a composite Higgs or whatever. There is a limit in which the Higgs is just a Goldstone boson of zero mass, and the symmetry is broken by some small parameter which generates the Higgs mass, because after all the Higgs is very light. Okay? So that's one of the ideas that people are discussing. The other interesting idea, which probably is even more interesting, is a scale symmetry. There is a limit in which the scalar mass goes to zero, is if you assume that all your interactions are invariant under scale transformations. In that case, all mass scales should go to zero. And then there is a limit, the limit where scale symmetry is exact, where masses are zero, quantum corrections cannot do much there. You will have some small breaking of the symmetry at some point. This small breaking will generate the Higgs mass and will generate everything. So it's another interesting idea that people are talking about, and the idea mainly relies in the assumption that at some high scale there is some underlying theory with some conformal symmetry. This is more than just a scale symmetry. Okay? You break dynamically the symmetry, and from there the everything appears. So I am not going to discuss anything about that, okay, but just have in mind the kind of problems why scalars were not considered to be good objects. And of course you have supersymmetry. Okay, supersymmetry was designed just with the argument, okay, fermions are protected, scalars are not protected, so let's use a symmetry that puts scalar and fermions together. Okay, relates spin 1/2 with spin 0. So the protection of the fermions then will protect the scalars. And that's supersymmetry. Of course, the minimal supersymmetric models, LHC is telling us that they don't work the way they were supposed to work. So everything is open. Any question up to here? So I will not enter in any of these things. I will try to be more general, but the things I am going to talk about are things that are being applied to all these type of systems. Okay, what else we know? We know that the Higgs is not just one scalar more. It's a Higgs. And we know that because we have been able to measure the coupling of the Higgs to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 objects, and even to put a band around on the muon coupling. Okay? And it's clear that the coupling is proportional to the mass. And you see here this line in the middle is just the standard model prediction. If you fit these couplings just with a parametrization which gives the proportionality to some mass scale, and you use as parameters of the fit epsilon and m, the standard model is epsilon equal to 0, m, the vacuum expectation value of the scalar field, 246. So if you just fit the couplings, you get epsilon compatible with 0 with very good accuracy, and m compatible with 246 with very good accuracy. So it is a Higgs. And in addition, it's a Higgs which really looks like a standard model Higgs. But maybe within uncertainties can be still something else. So what else we could have? Well, there are possible three different possible scenarios that we could think about. The first and more boring one, it is just the Higgs of the standard model. Okay? It is it's a boring scenario because then we have already everything. We will be just testing with more and more precision the properties, but we already know things with quite good precision, and we will not see anything more in the near future. Of course, we don't believe in that because there are plenty of questions that the standard model don't answer. So there should be some new physics. The problem is that we don't know where this new physics lies. Yes? To the Higgs? Okay, that's a good question. And that's why I said before that the fast arguments with cutoffs lead to misleading arguments. So he's asking the question, the standard model has a Higgs, it's a scalar, while this scalar is not stable. Okay? Well, everything goes fine. What is the highest mass scale in the standard model? The Planck mass is not part of the standard model because the standard model does not describe gravity. Okay, so let me. Let's put that. So this is the standard model Higgs potential. Okay, what is different now? So you know everything. It has two parameters, the vacuum expectation value, and we knew it for many years because you measure it with the muon lifetime, the Fermi coupling. And now there is a second parameter, lambda, but lambda gets fixed in the moment you have measured the mass. So we know lambda, 0.13, okay? But this is, we know lambda at three level. What quantum corrections do to the standard model? Quantum corrections do exactly what I was telling you. Quantum corrections get dominated by the heaviest mass scale within the model. This is the top. The top mass is the top you cover times vacuum expectation value. So you get a quantum correction proportional to the top mass square with the loop factors, logs, whatever. And this quantum correction dominates any other quantum correction because the other fermions are lighter. Okay. So what the quantum correction does? It tries to push the Higgs mass to the same order of magnitude scale as the top. And this is what happens. The top is 170, the Higgs is 125. They are pretty similar. Okay? So there is nothing strange. Is this a problem? No. Okay? There is no correction proportional to any cutoff or to any Planck scale. That's wrong. Okay? The problem appears in the moment you embed the standard model within some new physics scenario where there is another scale. Then you need a protection. Okay? But we know, or we believe in new physics. So what we know is if you introduce new physics, make sure that your new physics comes together with some symmetry that avoids pushing the scalar mass to very high scales. That's the real problem. In fact, here you can put the problem nowadays in the opposite way, because we know the Higgs mass, we have measured it. It's an experimental number. Okay? We know the quantum corrections, we have computed them, two loops already. Okay? The quantum corrections, of course, renormalize things. What they renormalize? Lambda. Now lambda is lambda of mu. And this mu dependence compensates with this mu dependence, because this is a physical parameter. Now you can put things in the opposite way and express lambda of mu as a function of the Higgs mass minus that. And then ask the question, what happens if I change the scale, the normalization scale, and I go to very high energies? Lambda gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And then, surprise, the standard model potential appears to be valid up to arbitrary high scales. You don't need any new physics before 10 to the 10 GeV. Okay? Because the scalar potential is always positive definite, and therefore it behaves properly up to very high scales. At some point, lambda crosses zero. That lambda crosses zero is a problem because then your scalar potential is not positive definite. It goes down. Okay, it's lambda to the 5 to the 4. If lambda gets negative, the scalar potential no longer has a minimum. So it's not a stable situation. So the standard model cannot be valid beyond some scale, you need something. Okay? But if you analyze this behavior, you discover that where you cross zero is extremely sensitive to the exact values of the top and the Higgs. And just changing a little bit the top mass or the Higgs mass, then you change a lot the scale. And the top mass, for instance, we still don't know which top mass we have measured. We are assuming that it's the pole mass. So if you put away this assumption, the uncertainty increases, so we are in a very interesting situation. You can even, it's even more interesting because people has computed, say, okay, let's accept that there is an instability, the potential gets negative. This means that our universe, our vacuum decays, is not stable. You compute the lifetime of this decay, and it happens that for the particular values of the parameters we have measured, the lifetime of our vacuum is larger than the lifetime of the universe. So who cares? But you can put things in a proper way. So if you ask that the standard model to be valid up to the Planck scale, for this to be true, you need the Higgs mass larger than 129 GeV with some uncertainty. And you can see here, depending on who computes the uncertainty, there is a large difference, which has to do with the top mass definition. And the Higgs mass is 125. We are there. Now you can speculate as much as you want. But I'm sure something is hidden there. For instance, you could speculate, maybe at some very high scale, there exists a theory which has a conformal symmetry, so all mass scales are zero, no problem with scalars whatsoever. It gets dynamically broken, and then you go down and you generate the standard model. Okay? It's very easy to say, it's not so easy to implement. But you can speculate a lot. But in any case, the important thing you should remember, the standard model does not have any problem. Okay? The problem appears when you embed the standard model in a new physics model. But of course, everything we are going to discuss is assuming that there is a new physics mass scale, therefore we should face the problem, but not within the standard model. We should face the problem within the true underlying theory. And we need a symmetry. Is that clear? So again, that was a comment I did the first day. Avoid using cutoffs for calculations. Avoid using cutoffs for fast arguments. Because if you are clever, you will do the right calculation or you will do the right argument, but it's very easy to be misleading or even to get a wrong result. Okay, so let's go back. These are the possible scenarios. So, first one, a standard model. Second one, there is some type of Higgs-like mechanism, but it's not just the standard model, it's something more. Some extended scalar sector. This is, for instance, the type where supersymmetry will enter. Supersymmetry has two Higgs doublets. Just look into precision tests, lab physics, better you use only doublets and singlets, otherwise you will have problems with electroweak precision tests. Because things which are valid in the standard model, in the moment you add, for instance, some scalar triplet or some higher representation, you immediately get bad corrections that you will not like to get. The other possibility is dynamical electroweak symmetry breaking, something similar to what happens in QCD. Okay, that will be much more interesting. I already pointed out the possibility of a pseudo-Goldstone Higgs, and there are hundreds of papers talking about this possibility. And there is a second one, which is more QCD-like, Technicolor. Okay, so you have some kind of technique quarks, which make a composite state, which is the Higgs. But this nowadays is not so easy to make, because the Higgs is very light. And it also appears to be very narrow. Okay, so it's not so simple. But you can work a lot. I will not enter into any explicit model. Okay, want to be general. What all these things share among them is that in any of these scenarios, the Higgs is not alone. So there should be additional degrees of freedom, and therefore we should be able to find additional objects. If we are lucky and the scale of new physics is not too high, LHC will find some objects. If we are not lucky and the scale of new physics is very high, then we need to wait. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, LHC has done much more than that. Because LHC has been looking to all type of searches, and you know already that he didn't found anything. But negative searches also give a lot of information. This is, for instance, a very simplified chart of supersymmetric searches. Okay? So it's plenty of different bounds. Every bound has some hidden assumptions with which the analysis has been done. The assumptions are different for every search. Okay? But there is a thing in common to all of them. Here you see the mass scale. And what you see is that any supersymmetric particle below 1 TeV is basically excluded in the usual minimal supersymmetric models. Of course, you can always fine-tune your model, so you can always make a hole and you can always make a space, but the usual models that people were considering just 5 years ago are in serious difficulties. Okay? Maybe some supersymmetry is there, but it should appear at higher scales. But it's not only supersymmetry. Those are searches for all types of crazy models that people have been thinking about. Excited fermions, new gauge bosons, gravitons, leptoquarks, compositeness, extra dimensions, whatever. Again, every single bound has some assumptions, some model with which the data has been analyzed. And you can change your assumptions so that you evade the experimental constraints. But if you look to the scales, now depending on your model and your assumptions, you typically have bounds which are always at the level of the TeV, and in some cases even at the level of 20 TeV, where nothing has been found. Okay? Does it mean that nothing is there? No. What it means is whatever is there is not what we had in mind 5 years ago. And since it is not what we had in mind 5 years ago, better we don't insist interpreting the data in terms of our old models. Let's try to be a little bit more modest, a little bit more general, and let's try to learn something from the data, because it's the only thing we can do. Of course, you can keep looking for models which avoid the constraints and looking. This is a legitimate thing that you should do, but from time to time you should try to look to a broader landscape. So, what this has to do with effective field theory? Because this is what we have. We have an energy gap. Okay? We have some energy scale of the order of 200 GeV, the highest mass object that we know is the top, 175. Everybody else, including the Higgs, is below 200 GeV. Okay? So we have our light degrees of freedom at the electroweak scale, and we have our low energy effective theory at the electroweak scale, which is called the standard model. We believe that there is new physics. Maybe we are wrong, okay? But that's what we believe, because there are things the standard model does not explain. But since we didn't find anything up to the TeV, it's very plausible that nothing is there, and therefore, if there are new objects, let's put some scalar, pseudoscalar, vector, axial, even fermion, these new objects at a much higher scale, we don't know where. Let's call this the new physics scale, and let's assume that it's at least of order TeV. So this is the perfect scenario to do effective field theory. You need to build an effective Lagrangian with the right symmetries, which are the right symmetries, the symmetries of the standard model, the symmetries we know, plus any symmetry assumption you want to make, if you want to make guesses. And you write a tower of operators, the most general tower with the most general type of operators, which have this symmetry. And these operators can only be function of the light degrees of freedom, the things that you have measured. Okay? Now, you need to analyze physics with these operators, try to fix their unknown couplings in the same way that we fixed the Fermi coupling constant many years ago. And we learned from the Fermi coupling constant that there was some object at 100 GeV. Okay? If we are able to find something like that, some new operator beyond the standard model with a non-zero coupling constant, this non-zero coupling constant will tell us at which scale and with which coupling we should look at. Okay? So we try to uncover whatever underlying dynamics is above. So, what you are supposed to do, you write the most general Lagrangian with the standard model gauge symmetries. It should contain only the light fields, the fields we know already. And in this effective Lagrangian, the standard model is just the first term, the dimension for operator, the marginal operators. But now there should be operators with higher dimensions, which are suppressed by powers of the new physics scale, whatever it is. Of course, if the new physics scale is the Planck mass, forget. See? Because it's going to be everything so tiny that you will never find anything. And we don't know where the new physics scale is. The coefficients, in fact, you can only fit coupling divided by the scale to the given power. Okay? But this is what contains the information on the underlying dynamics. For instance, if you have a vector which couples to the light fermions with some coupling, okay, it's like W exchange in the standard model. You get a low energy, a four fermion operator, with a Fermi-like coupling, which is proportional to G squared divided by the mass of the object squared. And you want to find that. Is the effective field theory unique? The answer is a clear no, because you have options. You have options because you can decide whether you want to put more symmetries or less symmetries, and this changes your theory. It's a dynamical assumption. But you also need to make a choice for the Higgs. Okay. What is the usual assumption that everybody, or basically nearly everybody, makes? You assume that the Higgs is part of an SU2 doublet, as in the standard model. Okay. And making this assumption, now you build invariant operators. Okay. But this is an assumption. And data seems to point out that this assumption is not far from the reality, okay, because it works. But you don't need to make the assumption. You can perfectly assume that the Higgs is just a singlet under SU2, okay, which has implications and is a much more general assumption of the previous one. You get a different effective theory. They are not equivalent. In fact, the first effective theory is just a particular case of the second one. And I want to discuss that with a little bit of detail. Or you can tell me, okay, I'm sure that next year LHC is going to find a second scalar. Because I believe in some models, maybe supersymmetry, maybe whatever, and there is a second scalar at 215 GeV. Well, if you find that, the second scalar will be one of the additional light fields. Therefore, you should include the second scalar into your effective operators, you will have a different effective theory with more light degrees of freedom. Okay, so you need to specify which is your starting point. Okay, let's analyze the standard model mechanism, because I think that if everybody understands really the Higgs mechanism, everything becomes more simple. What was the problem of the standard model? The problem was gauge invariants. All the standard model is built from gauge invariants, but you know that gauge invariant forces all masses to be zero. Okay. What means that the W and the Z have zero mass? Well, they have a spin one. A spin one particle of zero mass only has two polarizations. Well, a spin one particle with mass has three polarizations. There is no way in the standard model that you can generate a W mass or a Z mass without changing the standard model. By the standard model, I mean the exact gauge symmetry standard model, the original one. Because going from 2 degrees of freedom to 3 degrees of freedom is not a continuous limit. You need a big change. What is the Higgs mechanism? Because you always look, you see the potential, and you talk about the spontaneous symmetry breaking and things like that. You don't break any symmetry. What you are really doing is, I have 3 gauge bosons, W plus, W minus, and zero, which only have 2 degrees of freedom, 2 polarizations. Therefore, I have 6 degrees of freedom. To have 3 massive spin 1 particles with 3 polarizations each, I need 9 fields, 9 degrees of freedom. So I need to add by hand to the standard model 3 new fields. Otherwise, I cannot get masses. So what you do is you look for the most efficient way to add 3 degrees of freedom to the standard model in a gauge invariant way. Because you cannot break gauge symmetry, otherwise you lose the good ultraviolet behavior of the standard model, what you were calling renormalizability. And the standard model does not predict anymore the good things. So that's what you do with the Higgs mechanism. You add 3 additional degrees of freedom, 3 real scalar fields, so that you have 6 plus 3 equal to 9. How do you do that? You add some scalar potential or whatever, which contains 3 Goldstone bosons, which are also massless. Okay? You do that in a gauge invariant way, okay, so that you have 9 degrees of freedom. Then you use gauge symmetry so that you can go to some particular gauge, and in this particular gauge, it looks like that you have 3 massive gauge bosons. And what it was found many years ago is that the easiest way to add 3 degrees of freedom to the standard model is to add 4 instead of 3. But there is no reason why you should add 4. It's just minimality. It's simpler. Because with 4 degrees of freedom, you can add an SU2 doublet. It's a complex doublet, has 4 degrees of freedom. So 3 of them will be the Goldstone bosons. 1 of them you don't need, so you have added something more. So you add this scalar term, which is gauge invariant exactly, but which has a potential with a flat direction. In fact, with 3 flat directions. And these 3 flat directions are the 3 Goldstone bosons. Okay? You can parameterize your 4 degrees of freedom in polar form. Okay, and here you see 3 degrees of freedoms go along the valley. Those are the Goldstones. The 4th degree of freedom is something additional that goes up the hill, and therefore it's a massive state. It's like the sigma yesterday. But the potential is the same. The Lagrangian is the same. And you know the rest. You use gauge symmetry, you go to the unitary gauge, so you put that to 0, and then you discover that this kinetic term of the scalar field in the unitary gauge is just a massive term for the W and for the Z. Okay? Since physics is gauge invariant, in any other gauge, the Lagrangian will look different, will look more complicated, but you will get the same physical predictions for everything you compute. So the predictions will always correspond to the physics of massive W and Z bosons. And of course, you get this nice relation that you know that it works very well. Okay? So what is strange of the standard model? That instead of having 3 Goldstones, you have added 4 degrees of freedom. So there is a 4th degree of freedom that you didn't need at all, and this is the Higgs. Of course, I can do the same without any Higgs. And I will generate in the same way the W and the Z masses, and I will show that in a moment. So the Higgs was not compulsory. But it's not only the minimal way of doing that, it's the simplest one, because it's in this way you do it with a renormalizable Lagrangian. That's what is nice of the Higgs mechanism. Simplicity. Okay, let me play a bit. So, I take the scalar sector of the standard model and I rewrite it that way. So, it's the same up to a constant, but the constant is irrelevant. So, now my 2 parameters are lambda, the slope of the 5 to the 4th interaction, and the vacuum expectation value, which I have made explicit. And this, of course, reminds you of the linear sigma model I was talking yesterday at the beginning. So let me change notation to make things even more similar. So I take the Higgs doublet, which has a charged Higgs and a neutral Higgs. And now I take the C conjugate of the Higgs doublet. Okay? And the charge conjugation, I change the doublet and I get another doublet. So this means that the Higgs doublet has four real fields. So I parameterize these four real fields with these four variables. Phi plus, phi minus, phi zero, and phi zero complex conjugate. Those are my 4 degrees of freedom. And I call that sigma. It's a 2 times 2 matrix. Okay. I rewrite my scalar potential in terms of sigma with traces in the two-dimensional space. This is exactly the expression I had yesterday. Okay? It's the same. Only the names I was using yesterday and the names I am using today are different. Yesterday I was talking about pions and sigmas. Let's look. Yesterday I was saying this Lagrangian has an SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry, which is broken to the diagonal SU2. Why? Because I can take this sigma matrix, I can change with an SU2 transformation in the left, with a different SU2 transformation in the right, and everything is invariant. Of course, I am talking about global transformations, not Gauss transformations. And so there are 2 SU2 symmetry groups, one in the left and one in the right. And the potential, once I do the spontaneous symmetry breaking, I fix a point where I start and say, this is my true potential. I make a choice. This choice only remains in the same form if I transform with SU2 transformations, which are the same in the left and in the right. Because the minimum appears what sigma is, the diagonal matrix. Sigma is VV. It's the vacuum expectation value times the diagonal 2 times 2 matrix. So, and only remains in this form if I take SE2 transformations, which are the same in the left and in the right, SE2 vectorial. So this is the pattern of symmetry breaking that has my Lagrangian. The same of the linear sigma model, because it's the same model. Let's take polar coordinates. Okay, yesterday I was writing here sigma. Now I write H, notation. The Goldstones are the SU2 phases. Okay? You put it here, and the Lagrangian is V squared divided by 4, trace of derivative U daga, derivative U, plus terms, which contain the Higgs field normalized by the vacuum expectation value. So if you forget about the Higgs for a moment, let's imagine that the Higgs is extremely heavy, so you decouple it, you don't need it. This is the Goldstone Lagrangian of QCD. It's not that it looks like the Goldstone Lagrangian of QCD. It is the Goldstone Lagrangian of QCD. Why? Because it has exactly the same pattern of symmetry breaking. SU2 left times SU2 right, which gets broken to SU2. Of course, there are differences. But let's look first to the similarities. If you take all my predictions of yesterday in QCD, and everywhere you change pion decay constant by electroweak vacuum expectation value, and you change pion by electroweak Goldstone, which is the same, longitudinal W's and longitudinal Z's, okay, all the predictions I had yesterday apply. You don't need to compute anything else. You just need to copy. Because the dynamics is the same. You just change names. Of course, there are differences. Where the differences are, here I have a covariant gauge derivative. This is a global symmetry. Okay? But in the standard model, you make this global symmetry local, because you base your model in gauge invariants. And when you make it local, you don't gauge SU2 left times SU2 right. You gauge the left part, but you only gauge one subgroup of the right part, the U1 hypercharge. Okay? So in the moment you go to the gauge theory, you are making an explicit breaking of chiral symmetry. Okay? But this explicit breaking of chiral symmetry is crucial, is critical to the standard model, because it's built on that. Okay? So in the same way that yesterday I was trying to find out what is the breaking of the physical effects induced by quark masses, for instance, or electromagnetic interactions, or whatever, here I will need to worry what happens because I only gauge one piece of this SU2 right. And this will have many things hidden. Okay, let's go a little bit ahead. So let's write a Goldstone Lagrangian. Let's forget about the Higgs for the moment. So we know that we have introduced three Goldstones in order to generate masses to the W and to the Z. Let's write the most general Lagrangian which contains the Goldstones, order as powers of energy over some scale. In QCD, your Goldstones are parameterizing excitations over the quark condensate. Okay, because you have broken the symmetry dynamically. In the electroweak sector, your Goldstones are just excitations over this electroweak minimum of the scalar potential, whatever it is. But the Goldstones look the same. It's just here in one case this is f-pi, in the other case it's 250 GeV. You do an expansion in powers of momenta that involves derivatives. Okay. In QCD I was using the argument parity is a good symmetry, so I can only have an even number of dimensions. Okay. In the electroweak sector, parity is not a symmetry. But be careful, parity is not a symmetry in the fermion sector. So if for the moment I am not going to talk about fermions, if you look to the gauge sector and you look to the a scalar sector, before you introduce the fermions, you can define some type of parity. Because what is parity? You interchange left and right. And this potential is the same potential as before, as yesterday. So it has the same symmetries. So, even number of derivatives. We know how they transform, either if they come from here or from here. So, at lowest order, there is only one operator. It contains two derivatives. That's what we found in the Higgs potential. Okay? But this is more general than the Higgs potential. This is the Goldstone dynamics at lowest order of the standard model Higgs potential, of QCD, and of many other dynamical theories. Any theory which has the pattern of symmetry breaking is completely generic. Okay. And of course, Goldstone become free particles at zero moment. Now we want to build a true electroweak effective field theory for the moment only of the Goldstones. So what is the difference with QCD? The difference is that now I want to put here real gauge covariant derivatives, because I know that the standard model is an SU2 left times U1 hypercharge gauge theory. So I need to put my W's and my Z's, okay? Don't lose time looking to notation. The notation, you learn it when you need it. So let's look to ideas. So I have a 2 times 2 theory. So I have this matrix for the Goldstones. Everywhere where there was a pion yesterday, now we have a phi. This is this exponential. My derivatives contain left and right gauge sources as yesterday. So it's the same thing, I just changed notation. What is new is that now I am putting kinetic terms for the sources. I want to quantize them because I want to make a standard model loops with W's and Z's. So you have a SU2 multiplet of left gauge fields and some SU2 multiplet of right gauge fields. So formally you have an SU2 left times SU2 right theory. But so is this. Okay? This Lagrangian is totally invariant under a local SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry. And I know how to build an effective field theory which has this property. The standard model means symmetry breaking terms. Where is the symmetry breaking in the standard model? The SU2 left gauge fields are part of the standard model, but the SU2 right gauge fields are fake because there is only a U1 hypercharged gauge field that is the neutral direction of SU2 right. Okay? So I will put in this magenta color whatever means an explicit breaking of the symmetry because we need to follow these breakings of symmetry. Okay, is that clear? Now, let's look to this kinetic or lowest order Goldstone Lagrangian. You go to the unitary gauge. The unitary gauge means you rotate away your Goldstones with an SU2 left transformation, so you take U equal to 1. What do you get? The mass term for the W and for the Z. Do you see any Higgs there? No. The masses of the W and the Z have absolutely nothing to do with the Higgs field. They are generated by the three Goldstones. The only relation with the Higgs is that you have introduced one scalar doublet where the four fields are together. So it's the Higgs doublet. The Higgs doublet is responsible for the generation of masses. But once you enter into this doublet, the Higgs field itself has nothing to do with the masses. It's just 1 degree of freedom more than you didn't need. The masses come from the Goldstones. In the same way, you know that pions exist. You know that pions have exactly the same Lagrangian. Yesterday, I was introducing external sources, saying, okay, I want to make explicit breakings of symmetry, which are due to some photon interaction, W interaction, Z interaction, Higgs interaction. Okay, so I was putting all these interactions in the external sources. So you do the same with the QCD Lagrangian and you find the pions generate a W mass and generate a Z mass, of course. Because the Lagrangian is the same and the W and the Z are also there in the covariant derivatives. Okay, so if now I take this is the pion field, but I look to the part of the covariant derivative which contains the W and the Z, I will find the same result. The only difference is that instead of 240 GeV, I will find 92 MeV, which is far too small. So it just adds a tiny correction to the W and to the Z mass that nobody cares about it, but is there. What is Technicolor? Technicolor is just the idea, before discovering the Higgs, of saying maybe there is no Higgs, but maybe this SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry that is broken to SU2 left plus right is due to some QCD-like theory which likes at the TV scale, which some Goldstones, technipions, which probably are composite of some fermions, technic quarks, or you have some technic QCD, And in this technique QCD, the pion decay constant, instead of being 92 MeV, is 246 GeV. So that this technique color theory will generate the proper W and Z mass, of course, with the exact relation that we have measured. Because this relation, MW equal to MZ cosinus of theta W, is not a property of the standard model Higgs potential. This is a property of the standard model's symmetry breaking pattern. So you write a Lagrangian that has SE to left times SE to right broken to the diagonal SU2, and you get the good relation between the W and the Z mass. Okay, is that clear? Questions? So let's stop 5 minutes. Any question up to here? Okay, let's proceed. I was telling you that the scalar sector Lagrangian, or at least more precise, the Goldstone Lagrangian at lowest order is the same as in QCD. And therefore, things that we have learned in QCD, we can apply them here directly. In fact, there are, you can see in the recent literature, many papers getting published with very long calculations that you didn't need to do those calculations. Because you just take those papers, you look to whatever they have computed, then you go to some paper which is 20 years old in QCD, and the same calculation was done 20 years ago, and the only thing that you need is you copy the calculation and you change notation. Because the calculation is the same, but you need to understand that it's the same calculation. And of course, if you understand that it's the same calculation, it has some advantages, because then you can avoid the mistakes that were done 20 years ago. You always learn from your own mistakes. So let's try to do something like that. Yesterday, I was showing the expansion of this Goldstone Lagrangian in terms of pions. Okay, and I was saying you get the pi plus and pi zero kinetic terms, plus the interactions. So I have copied the slide. The only thing I have changed is instead of slash pi, I have put the slash phi, and instead of f, I have put v. But it's the same Lagrangian. And since it is the same Lagrangian, I can copy the Weinberg calculation of pion-pion scattering. Okay? Yesterday I was putting just an S there, but it's I am putting a different isospin channel, depending if you put pi plus pi zero, pi zero, pi zero, pi plus pi minus, you get a slightly different result. Okay, but this is the result of pi pi scattering. There are two derivatives, so energy square, one of the Mandelstam variables, divided by the f square yesterday, v square today. And this is a trivial calculation. It's a three-level calculation done with this Lagrangian. And in the same way, you can compute 2 Goldstones, 2 4 Goldstones, 2 6 Goldstones, 2 8 Goldstones, because the Lagrangian contains everything. But what are the Goldstones in the electroweak sector? The Goldstones are the longitudinal polarizations of the W and the Z. So what you are actually computing is that. You take two W's, you use the standard model, and you compute WW scattering. Okay. And you put longitudinal polarizations, of course, because otherwise will not be the same calculation, and you get the same result. Up to terms which are proportional to mass divided by energy. So this is the high energy approximation of the scattering amplitude. And of course, if you have tried to do any kind of calculation with gauge bosons, you know that you need to invest much more time doing this calculation than doing the previous one. Okay? Just because here everything is trivial, while here there is a lot of combinatorics and gauge cancellations and things like that. But the result is the same. And it is the same because you have generated the longitudinal polarizations with the Goldstone mechanism. And you understand why it grows with energy. It grows with energy because Goldstone dynamics involve derivative interactions. But some amplitude that grows with energy means a violation of three-level unitarity. Because if now you allow the energy to go high and high and high, probability is larger than one, you are violating unitarity. Both in the pion theory and in the electroweak Goldstone theory. So a violation of unitarity is something serious, so we need to understand that. Because unitarity is not violated in QCD and is not violated in the standard model. Those are renormalizable theories with good short distance properties. What is going on here? Well, it's just a question to look to what a longitudinal polarization is. In order, you have some momenta of the W boson, and now you try to build the basis of polarization vectors. That usual transverse polarizations are pointing out in these two directions, which are zero, they should be orthogonal to the momenta. The longitudinal polarization has this form. It is the third direction, which is orthogonal to K, but it should be properly normalized, so epsilon squared should be minus one. And that's why you get this mass here. And of course, this at very high energies, if you can neglect the W mass, so K0 and modulus of K is the same, this is just K mu divided by the W mass. And just look into this polarization vector, you see that the limit of W mass going to zero does not exist. You will never get a prediction of the massless theory taking the limit of W mass going to zero of this. Why? Because the theories are just different. In one theory, the W has only 2 degrees of freedom. In the other theory, the W has 3 degrees of freedom. That's why you have introduced the Goldstones, because you needed this third degree of freedom. And this third degree of freedom is clearly different from the other two, because it does not behave properly at high energy. In fact, that was the reason why before gauge theories, it was impossible to build a proper renormalizable theory of massive spin 1 particles. Okay, many people try it. But in the moment you put a massive spin 1 particle, it has a longitudinal degree of freedom, and the longitudinal degree of freedom behaves in this way. And at high energy, this is not a good behavior. So what you will expect naively, if you compute the scattering of two longitudinal Ws going to two longitudinal Ws, the equivalent of pion scattering, you expect this amplitude to grow as energy to the fourth. Why? Because you have four polarization vectors. Each polarization vector introduces a factor 1 over Mw. So you have a 1 over mw to the fourth, so you need fourth powers of energy to compensate dimensions, times some couplings. So that means that when you actually do this calculation, you are expecting this result. But that's not what you get. You get that it grows only as the square of the energy and not as the fourth power of the energy. Okay, why you get a better behavior? Of course, you know that you will get a better behavior because that's the result that you get in the Goldstone theory. What is happening is that you have gate symmetry. Gate symmetry involves cancellations. So there is an exact cancellation among these three diagrams, which is able to cancel two powers of energy. And that is what makes the difference between a normal theory with a massive spin one particle, that you will get that, and a gauge theory. This also means that you can test as much as you want these couplings with experimental data. You don't expect any big violation of the standard model prediction for these vertices. Because in the moment you introduce any tiny deviation from the standard model, you will recover the e^4. Okay? You need the gauge cancellations. Okay? So, probably the standard model is not the final answer, it's not the correct theory of the electroweak interaction, but it's very close to it. We can only allow tiny deviations, not large deviations, because the structure is very cleverly tuned in order to build cancellations. Of course, this cancellation, you have killed two powers of energy, but it's not enough. This still violates unitarity. What the standard model has in addition? The Higgs. The standard model, because you have introduced 4 degrees of freedom instead of 3, is a renormalizable theory, marginal operators. And this means that it has a good ultraviolet behavior. And that means that you have 2 additional diagrams exchanging the Higgs. The couplings of the Higgs to the Ws and to the Zs are fixed by gauge symmetry again, and they are fixed in such a way, look here, this is the Goldstone contribution, this is the Higgs contribution, the coupling is exactly the same. And since it is exactly the same, you kill 2 additional powers of energy. So you go from energy to the 4th power to energy to the 0 power. And to cancel 4 powers of energy is not a simple game. So again, now we have measured the Higgs coupling to the W and to the Z, looking to the Higgs decays, and surprise is the standard model coupling with an uncertainty of 10%. Is a surprise? No. It will have been impossible that this coupling will differ from the standard model 1 in a significant amount. Because otherwise this cancellation will not be there. So it's very important to test this coupling, but you need more precision. You don't expect large deviations. So only now we start looking into things that we can consider interesting. Interesting means that they are allowed by previous tests. Because we need this structure. Okay, still, when you add all the contributions, now we have an amplitude which at high energies behaves as a constant. An amplitude that behaves as a constant at high energies still violates unitarity. In fact, you can project this amplitude in partial waves. Okay. So I have projected it in the S wave, so I have integrated all the angular dependence. S wave means J equals 0, the quantum numbers of the Higgs, and you get this constant, Higgs mass square divided by V square and some pi's. Using just unitarity, you can prove that this projection with the factors I have put there should be always smaller than 1, otherwise probability is violated. So you only impose the probability that something happens cannot be larger than 1. And this means this should be smaller than 1, the Higgs mass should be smaller than something. I have had this blue factor taking into account that there are more scattering channels. Here I have only taken this one, W plus W minus going to W plus W minus, but it could go to ZZ, it could go to Higgs Higgs. So you need to refine the argument coupling all the different possible channels. The difference is a square root of 2 over 3, it's not very important. But this tells you that the Higgs mass should be smaller than 1 TeV, otherwise unitarity is violated. Okay? And that's why we were sure that LHC should find something, because LHC should be able to explore everything up to the TeV scale. Does it mean that the standard model violates unitarity? The answer is no. The standard model does not violate unitarity. But if you take the standard model and allow the Higgs to be very heavy means 1 TeV, what you are actually doing is allowing lambda, the coupling of the scalar potential, to be very large. So a Higgs of 1 TeV means that your scalar potential is non-perturbative. The coupling is larger than 1. And therefore, a three-level calculation doesn't mean much. So the standard model satisfies unitarity, but you need to work much more than just that. You need to do a proper calculation, resuming many things. In particular, here, for instance, I am just putting naive propagators, but the Higgs decays, it has a width. If you compute the width in the standard model of a Higgs which has a 1 TeV mass, the width of this object is 1 TeV. Which means that the light Higgs is very narrow. As you increase the mass, the width of the Higgs increases, and at some point, is flat. Is that a particle? You will never see that as a particle. You can see some enhancement, some cross-section, but you don't see not even a resonance. So you are deep in the non-perturbative regime. Therefore, that will have been a possibility for LHC, but this possibility will have meant that we don't find a Higgs, not a light one, but then in the moment we go up in energy, let's say 500 GeV or something like that, we start finding fancy signals which are more QCD-like, funny hadronic structures in the electroweak data. Okay, but that's not what we found. Okay, so let's compare the situation in the electroweak sector and in QCD. Because the Goldstone dynamics formula is the same, the parameters are different. So QCD satisfies unitarity, it's a renormalizable theory. And the standard model satisfies unitarity. In QCD, the Goldstone theory violates unitarity, it grows with energy because of the derivative coupling. And in the standard model, the Goldstone theory violates unitarity. In QCD, unitarity is restored by the exchange of the heavy degrees of freedom, the ones we have integrated out going to the effective theory. Particular, in P-wave, J equal 1 is the raw meson, that one that recovers unitarity in QCD. You produce two pions. Two pions give an amplitude which grows with energy, but then as the invariant mass of the two pions gets close to the rho peak, to the rho mass, you find a huge form factor with the rho, which completely changes the behavior. Okay? So in order to recover unitarity, you need to go up in energy and include the rho meson in your effective theory. So it's not a formal problem. It's a problem of validity of your effective description.
If I go with energy up, then my
Okay, but that's precisely the point. So your fundamental theory satisfies unitarity, no question about it. You have built an effective theory just with the Goldstone degrees of freedom. And Goldstones give interactions with grow with energy, so at some point your effective theory is going to violate unitarity. But this is only telling you what is the limit of your effective theory. It's telling you that at some energy scale, you cannot trust your effective theory anymore. So you need a different effective theory which contains more degrees of freedom to recover the proper unitarity behavior. Okay, for instance, let's go back to the electro weak sector. Imagine that we didn't find the Higgs yet. We know that we only have W's and Z's. And we know that I compute these T-graphs with objects that I know, objects that I can measure, and this grows with energy. So at some energy, it's compulsory that I should find a new degree of freedom which cancels this behavior. This is the Higgs. And we found it. Okay? And the argument is only telling me that this degree of freedom should appear before one TeV. And this is the no-go theorem that at LHC you either prove the standard model or you find something else. And this was a theorem. It's here. Okay? If you do the same argument with the pion Lagrangian, then you immediately find that before one GeV, you need to find something. And you find it, it's the rock. Okay? But then if you want to do physics at one GeV, you need to build an effective field theory which contains the Goldstones and the rock. Otherwise, you cannot do physics. What happens with pion scattering in S wave, J equal to zero? Well, in QCD, the S wave is unitarized by a funny object called a sigma, some scalar. And this is a very, very funny object. So it was the sigma of the model I was showing yesterday. So it's a very old model. Okay? But the object is funny because this is a particle that for about 30 years, every 2 years, has been appearing and disappearing from the PDG tables. Okay, so the particle has been discovered many, many times and has been disproved many, many times. So depending on the experiment you do, you see the particle or you don't see the particle. What is the problem? It's not clear that it's really a particle. It is there, it's an object, but it's not a normal resonance. The sigma is just the effect of the final state rescattering of the two pions. So it's not like a row that you say is a QQ bar with J equal 1, blah, blah, blah. The sigma, you just take two pions, you make them rescatter, you do a Dyson summation of all the pion rescatterings, and this Dyson summation generates a pole in the complex plane. So is what is called nowadays a dynamical resonance, which is characterized in the QCD case by the fact that it has a very low mass and is a very broad object. And this object unitarizes the S wave. So there was the possibility, because this is the object that plays the role of the Higgs. So if you want, the standard model Higgs is the equivalent of the sigma in QCD. The difference is that the standard model Higgs appears to be very narrow, so the dynamics looks different. Okay? In a completely technicolor theory, completely means a QCD copy at the TeV scale, you will have expected the Higgs to be a more broad object. So things start to be different, but still there are many, many arguments one can give. Still, the Higgs can be light because of kinematics and things like that. So there are many interesting questions that you can address here. Okay, yesterday I was showing the order P to the 4 Lagrangian in QCD. There were 10 terms I was calling Ls. So what is the order P to the 4 Lagrangian in the electroweak sector with just Goldstones and nothing more than Goldstones? Okay? It was written by Applequist and Long et al. 20 years ago, so it's already old physics. It's just a copy of the operators in QCD with different names. The notation is slightly different, so everything has been rewritten in terms of things which transforms as G-left, G-left dagger, but this is something you can always arrange with your variables, so don't lose there. What is different from QCD are the symmetry breaking terms. Everything where I have put this magenta color is a term which breaks symmetry because you are only getting U1 hypercharge and not as U2 right. And you know that U1 hypercharge is just the neutral part of SU2 right. That's why it appears the Pauli matrix 3. Okay. And this is basic because if you don't build that properly, you are going to violate conservation of electric charge. So better you do it properly. But if you look to all the terms there, you see that magenta dominates. Put in a different way, if you tell me, okay, let's forget about G prime interactions, so let's forget for a moment about violations of custodial symmetry, which we know they are small, then there are only 2-3 terms that you need to care about. Okay? Violations of custodial symmetry, this SU2 left times SU2 right broken to SU2 left plus right, will violate the relation between the W mass and the Z mass. So we know that they are tiny. We don't know why, but they are tiny. But they are so tiny that if you count here, this operator with the label 0 is a funny operator because it only contains 2 derivatives. This object V mu is 1 derivative. So this operator is not in the standard model, and a priori we should have put this operator in our lowest order Lagrangian, not here. Okay? We didn't do that because first, it's not part of the standard model. Second, because it's an explicit violation of custodial symmetry, so we know that the rho parameter, the relation between the W mass and the Z mass, is one with a precision at the per mil level. So we know that the coupling constant of this operator should be very small. But of course, if then you are consistent with power counting and you say, okay, every time I have a violation of custodial symmetry, let's add my counting 2 powers more in momenta. That will be a consistent counting. Okay, if you do that, then every time that you have 2 break-ins, this is higher order, put it away. Okay, so there are many things that you could discuss about that. But since that was done 20 years ago, let it skip for a moment, okay, and let's try to discuss. What is the physics behind all these operators? Well, a priori is a bunch of higher order operators in dimensions, which are dimension 4 in the chiral counting, not in dimensions. So, one chiral counting more than my lowest order Lagrangian, and we generate corrections to my starting point, my standard model. So, what I will need to do is to measure physical effects of these operators, try to measure their couplings from experiment. If we find just 0, then we will be bounding the couplings, we will be bounding possible sources of new physics. If at some point you identify one operator where you see a physical effect, which is clearly different from 0, think about muon decay. So you measure muon decay, so you have discovered that the W exists. So here we are looking for the equivalent of muon decay. Okay? But so far we don't have any signal. But, okay, first counting. This is the counting I was showing yesterday for QCD. Since I didn't introduce so far any fermions and any strange things, I have just copied. It's the same. Okay. Once you introduce fermions, fermions break all symmetries. So one needs to be much more careful. How do you do predictions? The same as yesterday. The power counting of Weinberg tells you that you can compute at the one loop level with the lowest order Lagrangian, or at tree level with the new operators, which have one order more in chiral dimension. Okay, let's look at this table, because it's a very old table, probably is obsolete already nowadays, but it's a very interesting table. What it contains, remember we had 14, 15 operators from O0 to O14, which are parameterizing the most general structure in the Goldstone sector, coupled to W's and Z's, okay, of any type of new physics that respects my symmetry rules, including symmetry breaking through all these magenta things. And what I am taking here is three extensions of the standard model, three variations of the standard model. The first one is assume that you take the standard model and integrate out the Higgs. So you take the limit where the Higgs mass goes to infinity. In my Lagrangian, I didn't have any Higgs. So if I take the standard model and I take this limit, okay, I take the limit at the one loop level in the standard model properly, what I am going to find is my standard model without Higgs plus higher order operators which respect my symmetry rule. So I will be finding a 0 to a 14. So those are the couplings you find for these operators. So the Higgs that you don't see in the experiment is leaving a signal in your couplings. Of course, now this is obsolete because now we know that the Higgs is light. But that could have been the case. Here is you assume that there is a fourth standard model generation. Now we know LHC is telling us that this does not exist. Okay? But assume that you had a fourth standard model generation, and now you take the limit where the mass of one doublet of this generation, let's call T prime B prime, they have a common mass that goes to infinity. So where do you see these objects? You see these objects in operator 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 11. It just gives an additive constant contribution. Or this other possibility is you just take the three generation standard model, but you take the top mass going to infinity. This is more close to the real situation, because the top is the heaviest scale in the standard model. So there are many standard model loop calculations that you can do taking the limit of top mass going to infinity. You get the leading quantum corrections to everything. Well, you find the result. So you find many locks. You are computing at the loop level to find that. But if you look here, this is a hard mass square correction, which, surprise, appears in the operator 0. The one I was telling you that we should include this operator at lowest order, but we didn't because it violates custodial symmetry, and we know that custodial symmetry is tiny. So top loops are explicit breakings of custodial symmetry, of course. Why? Because if you allow the top mass to be different from the bottom mass, you are breaking completely the doublet structure. So what are the most important quantum corrections in the standard model? The corrections proportional to the top mass square. And who contains these corrections in this language? This operator. Where these corrections appear? These corrections appear in the self-energy of the W, in the self-energy of the Z. They also appear in Z going to BB bar, but then it's the operator 11. We'll see in a moment. So those are quantum corrections which appear in the standard model and which are very important. Okay? Of course, in addition, there are all type of logarithmic corrections which violate custodial symmetry. You can see here many zeros. This doublet, you didn't break custodial symmetry because you put the T prime and B prime at the same time to infinity. So it's plenty of zeros. But here you have things which are different from zero. If you analyze the case of Higgs mass going to infinity, you see that there are only logarithmic corrections. There is not a single correction proportional to the Higgs mass square. This was discovered by Bellman many, many years ago. What is the reason? The custodial symmetry structure of the scalar model potential, which is preventing this to happen in the Higgs sector. And this is the reason why it has been so difficult to pin down where the Higgs mass was exactly. I mean, because we knew where the top mass before discovering the top through quantum corrections. In the moment, B0, B0 bar mixing was measured and was very large. In the mixing between the B0 and the B0 bar, there is a very hard correction proportional to the M top square. The mixing was very large. The only possibility was that the top was very heavy. Okay, and then you compute your quantum corrections, you feed the data, and the top should be close to what it, in the region where it has been found. However, the quantum corrections, depending on the Higgs mass, are only logarithmic for large Higgs masses. So, unless you know exactly where the top mass is, it's very difficult to find where the Higgs is. Because this type of corrections dominate over this type of corrections. And that's why we have been telling to the very last moment, electroweak quantum corrections, we like a Higgs which is not too heavy, but the chi-square cube curve is very... it's open, and depending on which top mass input I put, things move. Okay, it's just this problem. Okay, now we know everything, so this is an academic table. But you can do the same game. You say, okay, I have now a supersymmetric partner, which couples to the standard model, but which is heavy because LHC we didn't find it. So I take my model, I integrate out my supersymmetric partner, and I find out what is the prediction in this table for the coefficients. Because it's the only thing that we can measure. We are going to see if LHC can measure some of these coefficients, and if it comes at some point and it tells us A3 and A4 are different from zero, and what one has different sign from the other one, and they are about the same size. Now you need with this information to reconstruct possible models given this pattern of low energy couplings. Okay, the coupling. I'm sure you heard many times about something called Applequist-Carrasson theorem. It's a theorem proof many years ago, which says the following thing. The low energy effects of heavy particles, so heavy particles means things which are much heavier than our energy scale. Therefore, we don't see them. So, and the question is how they affect our low energy Lagrange. So, heavy particles give effects which are either suppressed by inverse powers of the heavy masses, so they decouple, okay, like the W mass in the Fermi constant, or they get absorbed into renormalizations of the couplings and fields of the effective field theory, which you obtain removing the heavy particles, integrating them out. Okay. So if you go to the publication, you can find the proof. A different thing is whether you will understand the proof. You need to see which are the assumptions and then proof it. You don't need to lose too much time because if you just think a little bit, the statement is just a statement very easy to understand. It's just the basic principle of effective field theory. I mean, physics at lower scales should not depend on whatever happens at the Planck mass scale. Okay? Therefore, effects of heavy particles are hidden in the couplings of your theory. And since the couplings of your theory are going to measure them in experiment, so who cares? Okay? But if you look to this table, then you can start making all types of questions about the decoupling theorem. Because, okay, here I have integrated out the top. The top mass goes to infinity. But I see a coupling that grows with the top mass. Is not counterintuitive? It means that my low energy coupling gets larger and larger as the top mass gets heavier and heavier. So what is going on? This does not satisfy the decoupling theorem. Of course, what it means is that some of the assumptions behind the proof of the decoupling theorem don't apply here. So what is interesting is to find which one of the assumptions. But this grows logarithmically. It does not satisfy decoupling. This grows logarithmically. This does not satisfy decoupling. This one, yes. 1 over m Higgs squared. This satisfies decoupling. But even those is just you add a constant. Well, imagine instead of a fourth generation, imagine that you will have had 50 new fermion generations. That before LHC was possible. Of course, with very heavy neutrinos. Okay? So each one adds a tiny number. You multiply this tiny number by 50. You had a huge effect at low energies from generations which maybe are at the Planck mass scale. Again, okay? It looks counterintuitive. Okay? What is going on? What is going on is the way you generate masses in the standard model. Because what I have been doing is take limits on the standard model Lagrangian. Okay? It's not a normal QCD type theory or electromagnetic type. So what the standard model does, the W and the Z masses are proportional to the vacuum expectation value to the electroweak scale times G. The Higgs mass is proportional to the electroweak scale times square root of lambda, the coupling of the scalar potential. The fermion masses are proportional to the electroweak scale times the Yukawa coupling. So there are two ways in which you can make the masses going to infinity. One, the normal way is to say the basic scale is the electroweak scale. So I make the electroweak scale large, keeping the couplings fixed. And if you do that, look to the Fermi coupling constant, coupling square divided by W mass square is 1 over the electroweak scale square, this goes to 0, satisfies the decoupling limit. When your scale gets heavier, the low energy effects of your physics disappear. And this is the right behavior. What we have done in this table is not that. Because what we have done in this table is to say, we know where the electroweak scale is 246 GeV, because this fixes the parameters of my Lagrangian. And now, fixing this scale, I make the masses of these objects heavy. The only way I can do that is taking the different couplings to infinity. Of course, I don't satisfy the coupling, because I am saying I have couplings which are very, very, very strong. Non-perturbative physics. Okay? But this tells us that everything related to masses within the standard model framework is very subtle. Okay, it's much more than just a Higgs field. So we need to be very, very careful. Okay, something I didn't want to enter, so I just mentioned so that you know that it exists, but I will not enter into the technicalities. Yesterday I was writing 10 operators in QCD, from L1 to L10. Today I have written 15 operators that Applequist and Longitano wrote many years ago, and this gives a complete basis. Of course, if you start trying to build the operators by yourself, you will find many more. Okay? But not all the operators you find are linearly independent. So one sum operator is a combination, a linear combination of some others. You can prove that through algebraic relations, or you can use equations of motion and transform the way of the operators. And for instance, if you don't put fermions, I didn't put so far, without fermions, some of the operators are just zero. They are not there. Okay? Or another one is a linear combination, so it's not linearly independent. Or another operator, I can transform into a fermion operator that I didn't put in my basis so far. That means that I can do many games, I can transform the operators from one form to the other, and that makes a mess in many articles because everybody uses a different basis. Okay? And unless you specify completely your effective field theory, you don't know what you are doing. So you need to be careful. Okay, things which are more intuitive. Let's go back. Okay, all this looks funny, algebra. Algebra means notation. Okay, so don't get lost with the notation. If you need that at some point, you learn the notation, you adapt it to your needs, okay, and that's it. What is hidden there? U's are Goldstones. In the unitary gauge, U is 1. Derivatives are covariant gauge derivatives, so the derivatives contain the W's and the Z's. I didn't put any fermions so far. I am just discussing the bosonic part of my theory. The B mu nu is the usual U1 gauge field, okay? Or the standard model. So if you go to the unitary gauge, all these operators convert into operators with 2 gauge bosons, 3 gauge bosons, 4 gauge bosons. So what are they correcting? They are correcting the self-energy of the W and the Z. They are correcting the triple gauge vertex of the W and the Z. And they are correcting the 4 field vertex of W's and Z's. Which means that now you go to the data, you go to the usual phenomenological fits that look for the gauge couplings of the gauge bosons, or lab physics, the self-energy corrections of the gauge bosons. Here we have very precise data, and then you start putting corrections or putting bounds on these couplings without any assumption, just in what is allowed phenomenologically. So it's just notation. You put that in some programming in your computer, and the computer does it for you. Advantage of this language, everything respects symmetries, and any model you could imagine is included in the analysis. Disadvantage, you are so general that unless you have a broad set of data, you cannot go very far. And so far, nobody has gone very far. We are lacking data. But of course, the next few years, this is the type of analysis that everybody will do once the data is here. So you should get ready for that. Okay, maybe it's a good point to stop because I assume you are already very tired. So tomorrow I would like to make a few comments more on this electroweak sector. And if we have time, I will try to make a connection with short distance physics, which means what we should expect from any kind of underlying dynamics, which is behind that. Questions? Everybody's tired. Okay, let's cut it.
Thank you.